Hi, I'm Moby, and I became a vegan in 1987. And veganism in 1987 was so weird and so obscure that no one even knew how to pronounce the word vegan. So many people are vegan for so many different reasons, for concern for animals, concern for human health, concern for climate change, concern for famine, for water use, for rainforest deforestation. We have the ability to create like a sustainable, ethical, wonderful world. So I guess if I have one message, it's let your conscience guide your actions.
Namen van vegetarische vleesvervangers of vegan vleesvervangers.
In allerlei talen. Frans, Duits, maar nog net niet Chinees. En dat is omdat in heel veel landen de vleeslobby bezig is om deze namen te verbieden.
Mijn naam is Marianne Thieme, lid van het parlement namens de Partij voor de Dieren. De eerste partij die niet de korte termijn belangen van mensen als uitgangspunt neemt, maar de planeet en al zijn bewoners. Ik zeg het graag en vaak. Wij waren in 2006 de eerste die openlijk durfde te zeggen dat de vleesindustrie een dramatisch effect heeft op ons klimaat. En kijk nu, het verzet tegen de vleesindustrie groeit als kool. Het Nederlandse gekostumeerde bal heet Prinsjesdag. Een mooi moment om aandacht te vragen voor de grote politieke macht van de vleesindustrie. Een industrie die onze enige leefomgeving bedreigt. En uitgerekend in Den Haag door onze overheid wordt gesubsidieerd. De camera's als instrument, een jurk als wapen.
De vleesindustrie probeert wereldwijd de plantaardige vleesvervangers te saboteren, te dwarsbomen door te eisen dat er een verbod komt op de namen ervan. Zelfs in Missouri kun je een jaar gevangenisstraf krijgen als je een vegetarische worst op de markt brengt. In Frankrijk kun je €300.000 boete krijgen. Nu kan het nog, dus ik heb besloten om vandaag op mijn jurk alle namen van vegetarische producten te laten printen, te laten borduren. En om op die manier ook de discussie te openen over de macht van de bio-industrie. Ik ga Kate Raworth ophalen. Zij is een Britse econoom. Baanbrekend boek geschreven over hoe we ons economisch systeem moeten veranderen. Nu gericht op economische groei, meer van alles. En zij zegt, nee, we moeten binnen de grenzen van de aarde blijven. En we moeten veel meer zorgen dat iedereen ook dat krijgt wat ze nodig heeft. Dus de donut economy heeft zij bedacht. En daar gaat ze alles over vertellen bij de Kamerleden straks.
Hello.
Hello. Hey. Hi, nice to meet you.
So nice to meet you.
So nice to meet you. Great to have you here.
Yeah, thank you for inviting me.
We've got a whole wing now. We started with just four rooms.
Yeah.
Now we've got a whole wing.
Fantastic.
So we are
wow.
growing. And this is my office.
Fantastic.
And hey, if you look over there, that's the Tower of Power. And that's where the Prime Minister works.
He literally works in there.
He literally works there.
Kate Raworth schreef De Donut Economie, een bestseller. Over de hele wereld wordt de Britse econoom uitgenodigd voor lezingen over haar visie op de economie van de toekomst. Een economie die rekening houdt met de grenzen van wat de aarde aan kan.
I wrote the book with the subtitle Seven Ways to Think Like a 21st Century Economist, really to take the long view. And I never tried to make it relevant or appealing to politics.
Yeah.
Because that's often got a very short view.
Really?
Yeah. Yeah. I didn't try to make it work. And I thought, I want to not be held back by that. I take the long view. What surprised me is the number of political parties in different countries and across the spectrum who've been interested. And this, I take as a really positive sign.
Of course.
That in politics, there is a real hunger for a new story, a new narrative, a new vision of the economy. I think we need to raise our sights. Ours is the era of the planetary household.
Yes.
And we have to ask the question, how do we manage this incredible, unique, living planetary household in the needs of all of its inhabitants?
Yes.
And what does that look like? To me, this is the meaning of 21st century economics, and it means we need to rewrite the models and we need to start in a different place with a different vision of what success is. To me, we're in the middle of a psychological drama between what I think is the 20th century extractive mindset that are always asking at the heart of companies, how can we extract more financial value, versus a 21st century mindset that is just beginning to be born, and we see it popping up everywhere, of how many benefits can we generate in the way we produce this apple juice, in the way we design a city.
There's abundance of food, there's abundance of products. Well, it's not for all the people, it's just for the happy few. Do you agree on that?
If you understand nature, she is abundant.
Yes, yes. She can provide everything.
Yeah.
But not for everybody's greed. But
right, for the need, as Gandhi
need.
Said.
Yeah.
And so we need to redesign our systems and our industries to actually work with and within the cycles of the living world.
Yeah.
And to me, that's the adventure.
Ready? Okay.
The real story of the laws of motion of economics that drives everything is that the idea that the shape of progress is never-ending growth. That no matter how rich a country already is, progress comes in the form of more growth, and that's what we need to solve our economic ills. These ideas have been written very deeply into the economic mindset, and I do believe that they have underpinned some of the reasons why we find ourselves at a place in the world now where many people still fall short on the essentials of life, where 1% of people own the same amount of wealth in the world as the poorest half of the world, and we've already overshot our pressure on the planet's boundaries. I think it's time for a 21st century economic mindset that actually recognizes the state of the world and takes on this 21st century challenge. So I would start economics, and I do. If I'm teaching economics, I start with a big picture, a first diagram. I call it the embedded economy. The economy is embedded in society, dependent upon social, cultural, and political institutions to function, embedded in turn in the living world.
Als ik in de zaal kijk, zie ik veel jonge gezichten. Het verhaal van Kate Raworth is het verhaal van een nieuwe generatie. Een generatie die gelooft dat de donut-economie, die rekening houdt met het klimaat, een van de weinige verhalen is die hen echt een toekomst biedt.
So I believe that we're the generation of plenty and they're the generation of responsibility and sustainability. Do you agree?
I do.
Yes?
Of course, let's not kid ourselves, it's all millennials everywhere, but I absolutely see a generation who have a different vision of the world.
Yes.
Who actually, and maybe they're disillusioned by whether they're growing up under this financial crisis, they're growing up being taught from a very young age about climate change. So they're asking questions about the world that their parents didn't ask. They are probably the first generation to grow up not with the expectation that life is going to be better for you than it was before.
Exactly.
Suddenly things have got more complicated and they question.
Yes.
And they adopt a different lifestyle and they don't want to own a car. And more of them are vegetarian or vegan.
Yeah.
And knowing that, again, knowing the connection between how they live, how they consume and their interaction with the world and their impact on the world. So I think it's an incredibly important cultural development in that generation.
Yeah. So a vegan diet or a vegetarian diet is living within the donut.
The way we eat, food production, has enormous impacts on the planetary boundaries. I mean, the production of meat, it generates methane, which adds to climate change. It requires a lot of land, converts a lot of land from its natural use. It requires extreme amounts of fertilizer to produce the grain that the meat then eats. Yes. A large proportion of the world's fertilizer use is actually used to grow grain to feed animals.
Feed animals in the West, yes.
Absolutely, it uses a lot of water. There's chemical pollution. So it has huge impacts. And if we want to combat within the donut, one of the biggest things that we can change is our diets.
Yes.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
In 2007 maakten we de eerste Nederlandse klimaatfilm die liet zien wat voor een desastreus effect de vleesindustrie op de wereld heeft. In Meet the Truth sprak ik met wetenschappers van de Wereld Voedsel- en Landbouworganisatie. En zij stelden als een van de eerste dat een heel groot deel van de opwarming van de aarde wordt veroorzaakt door de veehouderij.
This huge environmental impact that livestock have is not well understood by the public. It is not even well understood by the farmers themselves. So there is actually a strong case for regulating the livestock sector much more than is currently the case.
In de jaren erna volgden rapporten van de Universiteit van Minnesota, Chatham House, het Planbureau voor de Leefomgeving, de FAO en vele anderen. Maar ondanks deze alarmerende rapporten bleven doodstil in de politieke arena's als Den Haag en Brussel. Sterker nog, er gaan nog steeds miljarden aan Europese subsidie naar een industrie die de leefomgeving kapot maakt. De vlees- en zuivelindustrie. Het is tijd om te onderzoeken hoe we er nu voor staan. Ik ga op zoek naar oplossingen en hoop in een wereld van cynisme die zich steeds meer lijkt te berusten in de schijnbaar onoplosbaarheid van grote wereldproblemen. Het moet anders. En het kan ook anders.
Op straat voor het klimaat. Ik wil eigenlijk dat er meer aandacht voor komt in de media. Dat meer mensen erover gaan nadenken en erover gaan praten. Oplossingen worden gevonden en worden uitgevoerd voor het klimaat. Telt geld als de ijskast smelt. Deze wereld gaat heel erg over geld, zeg maar. En als de ijskappen smelten, dan maakt het geld helemaal niks meer uit. Dan heeft het helemaal geen waarde meer. Ja, wij hebben misschien geen stemrecht, maar we hebben wel een stem. Dus ik vind dat wij wel meer gehoord mogen worden.
Hoe staat de aarde er op dit moment voor? Een planeet die we inmiddels met 7,5 miljard mensen bewonen. Mijn zoektocht begint in Zweden, bij het Stockholm Resilience Center. Hier berekenen ze dagelijks wat de veerkracht is van de aarde. Professor Will Steffen is een van de auteurs van de Hot House Earth Paper. Een waarschuwing van de meest gerenommeerde klimaatwetenschappers ter wereld.
We're losing ice at a very rapid rate. The Arctic sea ice in the summertime is retreating. What does this do? It uncovers more dark ocean water. That absorbs more sunlight and it warms even further.
Het zomerse poolijs als voorbeeld van een domino-effect. Dit zijn de meest recente NASA-beelden van de Noordpool. In deze grafiek is het duidelijk dat het zomerijs in de afgelopen 40 jaar voor meer dan een derde is gesmolten.
We scientists call these feedbacks. We call them reinforcing feedbacks because they reinforce the warming that we have started. But the whole point is there are a number of these feedbacks that act like a row of dominoes. And when you start tipping them, the Earth gets hotter, it tips another one, it gets hotter again, it tips another one. And we reach a point where the Earth system gets out of our control and moves toward this hothouse Earth state. There are tipping elements in the biosphere too. A good example of that is the Amazon rainforest. So what's happening there? Okay, the Amazon rainforest needs a lot of rainfall, as you might guess, because it's called a rainforest. That rainfall comes from two sources. One is the Atlantic Ocean, and that's part of atmospheric circulation. The water evaporates, comes across South America, and drops over the Amazon. That's about half the water it gets. But the other half comes from the forest itself. So the trees respire water, which form clouds, which then come down as rain. So it's recycled. And that's about the other half. But humans are affecting both of these. climate change is actually leading to less rainfall coming in from the Atlantic. And as we deforest the Amazon, convert it into cattle or soya, we are reducing the recycling of rain. Once you hit a critical point, the forest will burn and burn repeatedly, and it will change into a grassland with a few trees. That's another tipping point. So we can identify 9 or 10 of these tipping points around the Earth. And the problem is each of these tipping points reinforces the warming. So there's going to come a point where we start tipping these and they act like a row of dominoes so that one tips the other, and it takes the whole system out of human control. So these tipping points together, once they start falling like dominoes, forms what we call a planetary threshold, a threshold for the entire Earth system beyond which humans lose control. We can stop emitting greenhouse gases, but the Earth will continue to warm because of these processes.
Will Steffen en zijn collega's hebben 10 gebieden op aarde gedefinieerd die het begin kunnen zijn van een domino-effect, waarbij de temperatuur op aarde niet 1, niet 2, maar wel 5 graden kan stijgen. Het voortbestaan van mens en dier staat op het spel.
Because these act like a row of dominoes, if humans push the most vulnerable ones too far and start tipping them, the whole row of dominoes goes down, the Earth changes to a much hotter condition from hothouse Earth. So it acts a bit like this. Let's just tip this tipping element here and see what happens. And there we go. So now we're in a hothouse Earth. So this is what we have to avoid. We have to make sure we keep pressure off these most vulnerable tipping elements so we don't tip the whole cascade. When you think about it, it doesn't take much to think about. This isn't very, see, it's tipping. It's not very stable. That is stable. So when we go to hothouse Earth, we're pretty sure that that's going to be a really, really hard state of the Earth system to get back out of. It's very stable, but it's not very good for humans. And that's the point we need to keep making, is we want to avoid starting this cascade. One of the most important questions we need to ask a scientist is, where will this domino effect actually start? We don't know for sure. And when people ask me that question, I say, well, I think we're pretty safe if we keep temperature at 1.5 or lower. That's the lower of the Paris targets. If we go up to 3 degrees, I'm almost certain we will have tipped the dominoes. So somewhere in between, I think, is the point where we may tip the dominoes. And so this is really a risk assessment. And I ask people, how much risk are you really wanting to take with your entire planetary system? Because that's really what we're talking about.
L'accord de Paris pour le climat est accepté.
If you look at the Paris Agreement and the agreements before that and all of the conference of the parties, the so-called COP meetings, they really haven't achieved much because greenhouse gas emissions are still going up. And in fact, they're going up at a faster rate now than they were 20 years ago. So obviously we have to do something different to get this whole system turned around. Well, there is an obvious thing we need to do, and that's to get our greenhouse gas emissions down very rapidly. That's emissions from fossil fuels, from energy consumption, but also other gases like methane and nitrous oxide, which mainly come from agriculture.
Nog een klimaatwetenschapper die erkent dat het produceren van vlees een belangrijke bijdrage levert aan de opwarming van de aarde. Er zijn nauwelijks serieuze wetenschappers die dit verband in twijfel trekken. Sterker nog, de roep om onze consumptie van dierlijke producten radicaal te minderen is alleen maar luider geworden. Er kan maar één conclusie zijn. We moeten die vleesindustrie stoppen.
Stop eating meat would help, because methane is a very potent greenhouse gas. It doesn't have a long lifetime in the atmosphere, maybe on average 12 years. But when it's up there, it's extremely powerful, much more powerful than CO2. And when it is in the atmosphere, it eventually gets converted to CO2. So it adds to the overall burden of greenhouse gases.
Ik ben op weg naar Londen. Het wordt door het Britse dagblad The Guardian Vegan Capital of the World genoemd. Wel, in ieder geval in Europa, denk ik. Het bruist in de stad. Er zijn veel nieuwe veganistische en vegetarische restaurants en winkels. En succesvol, zo blijkt. Ik merk dat in dit Michelinster restaurant in Soho, dat midden in een veranderingsproces zit. Gauthier.
Hello.
Hello, how are you?
How are
Very
you?
Very nice to see you.
Welcome to
Gauthier Soho.
Thank you. So this Come is in. Where the magic happens.
Absolutely. Let me show you where the magic happens.
De chef van dit restaurant is veganist geworden. Alexis Gauthier is zijn naam. Vanaf 2019 kookt hij in zijn Franse restaurant alleen nog maar plantaardig.
Is het hard voor een traditional French chef with a Michelin star to cook vegan?
No, it's not. No. Not at all. It's actually a great opportunity for a classically French chef like me to be able to go into the plant world. It's really inspiring. Really, really inspiring. My vision, or what happened to me, is a little bit different. My relationship with animals has really changed the fact that animals happen to have a conscious, mm-hmm. just like you and me.
Yeah.
They are not tool. I should not use them as a tool for me to express my creativity and ultimately to make money. That's just not right. Mm-hmm. Maybe 50 years ago, I would not have known that a pig before being slaughtered has the IQ of a 3-year-old child. But now I know. So how can I seriously carry on doing my job and make money out of my customers, knowing that there is a real...
creature behind
it. Yeah, there is a real person.
Feelings.
There is a real person. You need to use your knowledge, your creativity, to perhaps help change things. And that's what I'm doing. Now, every time I look, every time we create something in this kitchen, it's animal-free.
Before you became vegan, what was your signature dish?
Obviously, as a French chef, I grew up eating foie gras. You know, foie gras is this dish that you open for Christmas at home, and when you're a chef, you really feel you're a chef when you master the art of making a beautiful foie gras without guilt. But obviously now, I don't want to see foie gras. I don't eat foie gras. I don't use foie gras. But for my customers who came to my French restaurant and when perhaps not prepared to embrace my veganism, mm-hmm. I think it was one opportunity to show them that we could actually create something which was almost as good, or as good, or even better, mm-hmm. and had the same kind of spirit and deliciousness as foie gras. So we worked on creating something which is like a pâté.
Oh, wow!
You know, and
yes,
and we use the traditional French jars.
Mm-hmm.
It's still very French. In it's like rustic,
yeah.
And delicious, and this is our root. Our French roots are here, but they are pain free, they are abuse free, and
more. I think
and they are delicious actually. I tell my customer, it's this because first is the future of food,
yeah.
And secondly is now I've realized that there is a life beyond eating animals. Just try it.
Yeah.
Just please try it. Just
see. Free.
Just see how we can be as creative, still retain our Frenchness, and still do our jobs, and but while applying a very a vegan state of mind.
Dit is een prima plek om af te spreken met Oxford-onderzoeker Marco Springman. Hij heeft meerdere onderzoeken gepubliceerd over de impact van ons voedsel op zowel gezondheid als op het klimaat. Zijn meest recente onderzoek werd gepresenteerd op het World Economic Forum in Davos.
Well, we try to connect health and environmental dimensions of the food system, with a particular focus on dietary change. And we do that because the food system is so complex, right? I mean, we eat every day, and what we eat has tremendous impacts both on our health and on the environment. It emits so many, a quarter of all greenhouse gas emissions. It uses 40% of land, over 70% of fresh water, and tremendous amounts of fertilizers, which lead to dead zones. So clearly our food choices have a lot to do with the environmental degradation that we see and feel, but at the same time it leads to chronic diseases that are on the rise, like heart disease, stroke, cancers, diabetes, and overweight and obesity if we don't watch how much we eat, right?
Yeah.
So I think by connecting those aspects, we can really say something about what might be some choices that sort of optimize both health and environmental impacts.
Springman berekende wat de impact van ons eetpatroon zal zijn in 2050. Het jaar dat de CO2-emissie drastisch moet zijn gereduceerd. Voor zijn onderzoek maakte hij gebruik van 4 scenario's. Het gemiddelde menu van de gemiddelde westerse persoon. Een menu volgens de richtlijnen van de Wereldgezondheidsorganisatie. Een vegetarisch leefpatroon en een veganistische levensstijl.
So together would be around 1.5 trillion. Let's count the...
Zijn conclusies zijn spectaculair.
So we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11 zeros. I hope I got that right.
Als de wereld massaal overstapt op de veganistische levensstijl, zal dat 8 miljoen sterfgevallen per jaar schelen. De voedselgerelateerde CO2-emissie wordt dan met maar liefst 70% gereduceerd. En deze plantaardige levensstijl voorkomt toekomstige klimaat- en gezondheidsschade met $1.5 billion.
Unbelievable. It's hardly imaginable how much that is.
I mean, of course, those are all sort of forecasts,
of
right?
Course, of course.
And
yeah.
We do that to really illustrate what might the benefits be of dietary changes. And we also wanted to really put a dollar value on it to see what kind of political policies that usually come with a price tag would be worth implementing. And with this high price tag, you can imagine that lots of public health policies or environmental policies would, in a sense, pay for themselves if you factor in what the health and environmental savings would be.
Yeah, unfortunately, in politics, it's always about numbers. But these kinds of numbers really help us to raise awareness about how we can, with just very easy adjustments in our lifestyle, we can help our planet to survive.
Mushrooms, shallots, garlic, plenty of herbs, cognac, and walnuts.
Walnuts.
Yeah, to give the richness, obviously the fattiness you used to have in the foie gras. It
smells like foie gras. It's amazing.
It's a combination of the French cognac and the mushroom and the herbs. And actually, when you develop a recipe like that, and then you think back about the foie gras, you think, actually, we are using foie gras just for the texture. Nothing else. I mean, it was this pork duck was bringing the liver to the recipe. Yeah. And we could have lived without.
The big thing is that if we want to avoid climate change, we really have to do something about it. And the standard measure that people think about it is we need to price in the basically damages that greenhouse gas emissions would would create.
Yeah.
Exactly, the externalities. And in other sectors of the economy, like in the energy sector, that is done in Europe and in some other countries. So there is a price on emissions. For agriculture, that is not the case.
So, we continue with the stuffed courgette flour.
Oh, beautiful!
We have a smoked almond, fresh new season courgette. The flour actually stuffed with some delicious tofu.
All foods should be subject to a greenhouse gas tax, And it so happens that because meat and especially beef are so greenhouse gas intensive, that the highest tags would be on beef.
And dairy, I presume.
Dairy as well. Yeah. So we estimated on average globally, beef would need to be about 40% more expensive, meat and dairy about 20%. And that would, according to our estimates, result in a reduction of consumption and save quite a bit, 1 billion tons of carbon dioxide equivalents. So that is quite a bit. That is sort of a tenth of that emissions gap we need to bridge in order to get where we have to be in 2050.
When it tastes good, and when it's as delicious as what they expected, then we have won, you know?
Yes.
And maybe next time they go to a party and they are serving foie gras, they said, well, have you tried Gautier's foie gras? Because it's actually as good, but there is no animals.
No.
And then this is the business we are here. Daily basis, you know, we try to change the perception of people and from our corner. But I think as a chef, we play a very important part in this process, but it's a revolution. It's a revolution. It's not a trend, and I know it's not a trend because it doesn't come purely from the food aspect of things. A lot of people have decided to turn vegan, not because they don't want to eat meat, but because they don't want to wear a leather jacket. Or some people they turn vegan because they are tired of being sit on a leather chair in a train. Some people have turned vegan because their wife is vegan. Some people have turned vegan because one day a week they want to eat only. It's coming from everywhere. And this is when you can see it's very different from just being a trend.
Springman vertegenwoordigt een nieuwe generatie wetenschappers die niet langer te negeren is. En Gautier is trendsetter in de culinaire wereld. Er is in 10 jaar ongelooflijk veel veranderd. Een klassiek Frans sterrenrestaurant waar geen vlees meer op het bord komt. Wetenschappers die meer en meer bewijs leveren van de excessen van de vleesindustrie en de dramatische gevolgen ervan. Het is overduidelijk dat de westerse samenleving klaar is om plantaardig voedsel mainstream te maken. Je merkt het ook in de media. Zowel The Economist als Forbes en The Guardian riepen 2019 uit tot The Year of Vegan. We staan aan de vooravond van een grote omslag in denken. De nieuwe generatie vindt het niet meer vanzelfsprekend om dieren te laten slachten voor ons voedsel.
I had this conversation with Al Gore about 10 years ago and I asked him why he didn't mention animal agriculture in An Inconvenient Truth. And he gave me a very clear answer. He said, because the role of animal agriculture in climate change is too inconvenient of a truth for most people. You look at the impact of animal agriculture on human health, on healthcare costs, on rainforest deforestation, on climate change, on water use, on famine. Like animal agriculture, as we were saying, it's not just destroying animals, it's destroying us, and it's destroying the only home that we have.
Ik ben op weg naar Oxford, een gerenommeerde universiteit die nog steeds een icoon is van het klassieke Britse conservatisme. Maar ook inmiddels een van de meest vooruitstrevende universiteiten op klimaatgebied.
Oxford University's got a very strong agenda for trying to do good for the world, you know. So we want to do research that's actually going to have an impact in the real world and that's going to make a difference to policy and practice.
Ik ontmoet hier een collega van Springman, Joseph Poor. Volgens The Independent heeft deze zeer talentvolle onderzoeker eind 2018 het meest uitvoerige onderzoek ooit gedaan naar de impact van de vleesindustrie op de aarde.
So we assessed the environmental impacts of 40 different foods based on data from 40,000 farms from countries all around the world. And we assessed these impacts across the whole food supply chain. So from the clearance and deforestation of land for agriculture, right through to processing, packaging, transport and retail. And we did this for 5 important environmental indicators. Land, how much land is used to produce the food, greenhouse gas emissions, water use, and two measures of ecosystem pollution, acidification and eutrophication. Mm-hmm. We've collected data from about 750 studies who've gone to farms around the world, to retailers, processors around the world, and collected this data. Data on how much fertilizer they're using, what the crop yield is, and what the animal product yields are, stuff like that.
Het onderzoek van Poor begon als een studie naar de meest duurzame dierlijke producten. Om consumenten de mogelijkheid te geven een verantwoorde keuze te maken als ze in de supermarkt bij de vleesproducten staan. Maar al heel snel concludeerde Poor dat duurzaamheid niet samengaat met het eten van vlees, melk en eieren.
If you go out into the shops, it's going to be better to change what you consume rather than try and purchase sustainable meat or dairy. And another conclusion, as we scale these results up to a global level, we found that adoption of meat and dairy-free diets is probably one of the single biggest ways to reduce your impact on Earth. It reduces the land we need to produce our food by 3.1 billion hectares. It's an area this size of the entirety of Africa. That would take pressure off the world's last remaining tropical forests and possibly see land revert back to nature. Cut the world's greenhouse gas emissions by 23%. It's the same as the emissions of the USA and Europe combined. It would also reduce our impact on ecosystems and reduce the amount of water we use. These are just tremendous potentials of diet change. Absolutely.
Poor voegde de daad bij het woord. Tijdens zijn onderzoek stopte hij zelf geheel met het eten van dierlijke producten.
I think it also changed your perspective on what politicians should be doing, and the fact that we actually can and should be taking a much stronger position on the environment, which is, in my opinion, one of the biggest challenges we're going to face in the 21st century.
So your fork and your knife are the most impactful weapons against climate change.
As an individual, I think that's true. So yeah. It's the biggest way to cut your land use, and that would take enormous pressure off the world's last remaining tropical forests and natural ecosystems. It's one of the biggest ways as an individual to cut your greenhouse gas emissions, your water pollution, your air pollution, and your water use. It also has impacts on some indicators we didn't assess, environmental indicators such as pesticide use, toxicity. Currently in the US, 80% of antibiotics are fed to animals, 20% fed to humans. So, you know, the animal production system sits at the heart of such a large range of environmental problems. And diet change, vegan diets, are a really powerful solution to change and reduce these impacts.
Yeah.
We as consumers in Europe don't understand the extent of the global reach of our food systems and the extent of the footprint that consumers have in the world just from the choices that we make in our supermarkets.
What should be the role of the government, of politicians, to have a more sustainable food system?
Today, the governments around the world issue $500 billion of agricultural subsidies. So they control a massive amount of money. Small policy instruments as well could change the way consumers understand the environmental impacts of food. For example, labels, mandatory environmental labels on products. Policymakers could also require that producers actually measure their environmental impacts on farm. So there are small changes, and there's also this very large sum of money that policymakers control. At the same time, though, consumers and retailers have a role in this. Dietary change, vegan diets have a huge potential for the environment. Equally, there's all the variability, the different ways of producing a product show that producers as well have a very significant responsibility. And it's got to, you know, we've got to have action on all three fronts.
But is it the responsibility of the government to change the diets of people?
I think if governments in the 21st century don't take significant action on the environment, we will look back and say that there are many small changes and big changes that could have been made that weren't by governments. Mm-hmm. And I think that looking back and saying that they didn't make those changes, that would be a very easy and clear finger to point when there's so much power there to do something good.
Human history can best be summed up as creating terrible problems and then moving past terrible problems. We created slavery, we moved past slavery. We created cigarettes, we're moving past cigarettes. Like, future generations will look at us and be like, wait, they used animals for food? They used oil for energy? They used antibiotics to create sick animals that then were fed to people, which in turn made the people sick? Like, they're just gonna be so confused by our choices. And they'll be right. You know, we collectively as a species are making unbelievably terrible choices. It's up to the future generation to fix those choices and fix the consequences and hate us for it.
Coming now.
We zien een nieuwe generatie die het voortouw neemt in de verandering naar een plantaardige samenleving. Waarbij dieren als onze medebewoners worden gezien en niet als grondstof voor een maaltijd. Het duurt niet lang meer voordat plantaardig voedsel wereldwijd het nieuwe normaal zal zijn. Op steeds meer festivals wordt deze ontwikkeling zichtbaar.
We started thinking about it and we were like, wow, we have like 17,000 people here and all the food trucks are catering them and there's so much meat and the spilling of water that goes into, you know, like creating one burger. And it just made us think like, what can we do to make the world a better place or inspire people to think about what they're doing in their lives? And I was like, let's just stop selling meat at the festival. Why not? You know what, let's do this. Stop it. When we released our food line, because everybody was like, oh, it's just gonna be tofu and quinoa, that's the only thing we're gonna eat. And then we released our food line, and everybody was like, oh, fuck that, I don't care, there's no meat, it's delicious what we have. No complaints.
Ik ben echt dol enthousiast over. Ik heb het ook echt zo tegen mijn huisgenoot gezegd. En al het eten is vegetarisch. Ja hoor, ja, dat is echt een hele grote stap vooruit. Ik denk dat alle festivals dat zouden moeten doen.
Ik vind het heel mooi, en vooral op zo'n festival waar zo'n kleurrijk gezelschap komt. Allemaal mensen die toch wel met hun lijf en met hun body bezig zijn, zoals je ziet. Maar ik ben zelf veganistisch geweest, een maand of vijf. Ik heb heel lekker gegeten in die periode.
Everybody wants to drive green cars and be like, but nobody talks about meat being so bad. It's like, people don't want to know. And I also think it's bad that like these animals are on this planet just for our consumption. I think that's sick.
The food is delicious, we have so much choice. It really doesn't matter. And it's just, we hope to inspire people with this.
In de samenleving vind je steeds meer pioniers die in een snel tempo initiatieven ontplooien om te komen tot een duurzame wereld. Maar ze hebben te maken met oneerlijke concurrentie van de door de overheid gesubsidieerde en machtige vlees- en zuivelindustrie. Ook in Nederland zijn wetenschappers bezig met alternatieven voor het gebruik van dieren in de voedingsindustrie. Zoals hier in Wageningen, waar professor Adsian van der Goot ver gevorderd is met de ontwikkeling van een 100% plantaardige biefstuk.
We are going to our food hall and in the food hall there's our so-called Cuetta device. That's a machine in which we can make plant-based steak.
Een alternatief voor biefstuk wordt beschouwd als de heilige graal van vleesvervangers. De structuur van biefstuk was tot voor kort voor wetenschappers moeilijk na te maken. Maar in Wageningen denken ze een doorbraak te hebben.
What's so special about our plant-based steak is that it is a highly fibrous product. But also we can make it in a very large size. So you can really cut pieces of the steak out of a bigger one, just like the real steak. A steak is really appreciated by consumers because it has a highly fibrous nature and you can also cook it to different degrees, rare, well done. So to help people reducing their meat consumption, it is really helpful to have a product that looks like meat and behaves like meat and tastes like meat.
Thank you.
This is the dough. And we're now going to fill it in the filling system. We're going to put it in the filling system. So we're filling the dough that you've just seen into this equipment. And the only thing what's going to happen is that we're heating the whole system and the inner cylinder will be rotating. And that's how we make the plant-based steak.
The material is between those two cylinders and then it's deformed in what we scientists call a simple shear flow deformation. And what's so characteristic about that type of deformation is that if the material is suitable for that, it will align. It will form fibers. And the next step we are now making is to try to understand how we could scale up this technology to full-scale factory.
I think it's a very important development, what we're doing here. And it would be great if we can actually apply this technology and really make plant-based steaks for consumers to taste and to appreciate products like this.
This is the basis, yeah. And that opens up many opportunities. One of the things we are also thinking of is this possible to make such a device suitable for more local production? So that we don't produce meat analog in a big factory, but why not at every local butcher or local restaurant?
I'm now going to cut a small piece so that we can take the sample out. One large piece of meat analog. So now we are looking at the structure. So if we created a fiber structure during the process, which resembles meat. This looks like a good piece of plant-based steak.
The size makes it impressive, and that's really a new feature, let's say, for plant-based meat products, that it can be this thick and that large. So you can really cut a piece of meat out of such a larger piece, just like the real meat. I think this can be part of the future, yeah. In a few years from now, I think you should be able to buy those products, maybe in a shop or maybe in a local restaurant.
Hoopvolle initiatieven bij jongeren en wetenschappers. Maar hoe zit het met de vraag naar plantaardig voedsel? Voor het antwoord moeten we in Zweden zijn. Bij een bedrijf dat in de wereldwijde top 10 staat van restaurantketens. Terwijl voedsel niet eens hun kernactiviteit is. En daarom is deze Zweedse meubelgigant een belangrijke internationale barometer voor de opkomst van plantaardig voedsel.
We have about 680 million visitors that goes through our restaurants, our Swedish food markets, our bistros on a yearly basis. And if we measured in that context, I'm sure we're one of the bigger food companies in the world, yes. It's a privilege to have that many people, of course, but it's also a great responsibility. It's very important that our customers know where we have sourced our things, that we do that in a responsible manner, that we have standards that we want to live up to when it comes to animal welfare. And what we offer to our customers, and over the last years, to have a plant-based offer is something that our customers request, and that's a movement that's going on, and we want to be part of that, at times perhaps even inspired to that. Just a few months back, we introduced the veggie hot dog, or the vegetarian hot dog. We sell about 110 million standard hot dogs worldwide. So it's also a massive product on a global basis. And by introducing a vegetarian hot dog, we hope to inspire people to try the healthier, more sustainable version of a hot dog. Hey, this could be three veggie hot dogs. It is about having a product that appeals to the broader masses. That's how I think we move the agenda of plant-based. It needs to appeal across from people that are meat lovers to vegans to vegetarians. And when we do that, then we actually make a difference when we have just really good, tasty products and at price points that are available for the many people. I believe that's really the key.
Ik ben vaak kritisch op IKEA vanwege belastingontwijking en omdat veel producten dier- en milieuonvriendelijk tot stand kwamen en soms nog komen. Maar eerlijk is eerlijk, dit is een hoopvolle ontwikkeling. Elke heilige heeft een geschiedenis, elke zondaar heeft een toekomst, zei Oscar Wilde al. En in dit geval kan ik niet anders dan het met hem eens zijn. Het is voor de meubelverkoper ook een commerciële keuze. De klanten eisen het. En dat is een interessante ontwikkeling.
5-10 years ago, you probably wouldn't have seen anything that was vegetarian or vegan. And that meant that we were probably relevant for the many people back then. But in order to be relevant for the many people today, you need to have a vegan option. You need to have vegetarian options. It's just expected. Oh, the future is here. Absolutely. I believe that it was already here a couple years ago when we started, but it is here now. And there is no turning back when it comes to this trend, in my opinion. And we have a food system that needs to be challenged and needs to be redesigned, remodeled, if you will.
Vleesproducten hebben bij IKEA hun langste tijd gehad. Dus ook de beruchte Zweedse balletjes. En dat gaat sneller dan we allemaal denken. Ook vleesgiganten als Tyson in de VS, Unox, Kips en Zwanenberg in Nederland kiezen massaal voor plantaardige producten.
The importance of what you eat and how you share it in social media has really changed the game tremendously. And we see younger generations that are much more informed and are much more inclined to make their choices based on what they get offered. And I believe that they've taken lead in the food revolution. I usually explain it by my own daughters that are both vegetarians. We come out of a traditional meat family. My father was within the meat industry and I've grown up in that environment. But they've made a choice to go vegetarian and perhaps even flirt with being vegans. And they do it because of social concerns, because of concerns about the environment, about the sustainability. And they want the players where they would put their business, where they will buy something, to have a point of view and take responsibility. And that has started a movement that I don't believe will go gradually, but actually exponentially. Because I do believe that it changes behavior. I see it in my own case, in our own house, how their behavior has changed how we eat. And I think, again, a product like this is a good example. I found out that, you know, I'm not actually cheating myself by eating a great product, because you can do fantastic products that are plant-based. And through that, we see that it actually now spreads across generations. It is not, I think the young generation have to have credit for taking lead, but it's spread throughout. We see all kinds of generations going for the more sustainable options and actually going towards more plant-based. The scale of our change is, of course, massive. We have 420 restaurants around the world and serve, through all our different food entities, about 680 million people. So it's a massive scale. You need to be prepared from a supply chain perspective, how you source things, where you source things, before you roll anything new out. But it's always a quite big undertaking to do these things with this the scale of the business and wanting to do it right. Hey, Grünzogsbulla. When it comes to our long-term plans, we are focusing a whole lot of our resources and best product developers to focus around plant-based alternatives. Plant-based alternatives in a restaurant
but even in the desserts and soft ice is an area where we sell a lot of the traditional dairy-based soft ice, where we'll come in with oat-based or plant-based soft ice over the next 6 to 12 months. I think most people have started to understand that there is a dialogue to be had around the food industry at large, and also started to understand that there's a lot of great products out there. It's really that simple. There's a lot of great food that, when it's made from the bottom up and it's plant-based, is really good. It's good for the environment, and you do something good in that direction on a topic that I think most of us agree that we need to do something around. But you also do something for your own health.
Er is dus reden voor optimisme. De samenleving is klaar met dierlijke producten en klaar voor plantaardige alternatieven. Binnen afzienbare tijd zal vegetarisch en veganistisch eten het nieuwe normaal worden. In 2011 verklaarde de VPRO bij wijze van stunt haar eigen kantine van de ene op de andere dag vleesvrij. Het leidde tot een opstand. Het was misschien nog te vroeg. Inmiddels is er een mildere variant bedacht door de Nederlands hoogleraar gedragseconomie, Henriette Prast. Zij stelde voor de sociale norm volledig om te draaien, met behoud van 100% keuzevrijheid. Carnivore, geef het door!
Bij vrijwel elk diner, buffet of feestje is vlees nog steeds de norm. En zijn plantaardige gerechten de uitzondering. Terwijl bekend is dat het precies andersom zou moeten. Voor je gezondheid, het klimaat, de natuur en dierenwelzijn. Als er op jouw werk voortaan nu eens alle maaltijden bereid zouden worden, zodat ze geschikt zijn voor iedereen. Daar zou het toch een stuk gezelliger van kunnen worden? En wie er toch graag vlees of vis bij wil, geef dat gewoon even van tevoren door. Zoals vegetariërs nu hun menuwensen moeten doorgeven om iets anders te krijgen dan een vleesgerecht. Carnivore, geef het door. Dit briljante plan wordt inmiddels al op steeds meer plaatsen ingevoerd. Op het Nederlandse ministerie van Onderwijs, op universiteiten en in stadsbesturen. Wanneer ben jij op de zaak? Stuur dit filmpje nu naar de chef van je bedrijfrestaurant.
Change happens whether we're involved or not. It's just, do we respond beforehand or do we respond when it becomes a true crisis?
We do have to become stewards of nature, you know, in the sense that we have to understand the biosphere which we're part of.
Whether it's chemicals or food, we need all our industries to work with and within the cycles of the living world.
Now I've realized that there is a life beyond eating animals. Just try it.
Yeah.
Just please try it. It's such a sea of opportunity in terms of creativity. And I very often compare it to discovering a new planet for a chef. Because there is nothing can stop us. It's a revolution. It's a revolution.
Absolutely. The future is here. And there is no turning back when it comes to this trend. We see all kinds of generations going for the more sustainable options and actually going towards more plant-based.
Humans can be inventive, we can move quickly, we've seen in the past, and that is what gives us hope, is that we are a very clever species, but we have to realize that time is running out and we have to move now. Not in 2025, but now.